Turn in your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 15, and I'll give you the title of this one. Title of this message, and it's a word I've never preached before, although I'm going to reference some things that you may have heard over in Church Point. But Jeremiah chapter 15, we're going to be with verse 5 and verse 6. The title of this word is Relentless. Relentless. And Miranda, I came that close to calling and requesting you won't relent until you have it all, but he's going to be relentless this afternoon. Do you love God's word?
Amen.
Amen. Jeremiah 15, verse 5 and verse 6, and I'm literally picking up where he left off because I'm going to take that judgment. Again, he and I didn't have a chance to talk about this. I had no idea what he was going to preach this morning. He had no idea what I was going to preach this afternoon. And we got together in the Sunday school class just before Jimmy drove away from here, and we were just, he was looking at my notes, and he was going like, oh, my Lord. So we're picking it up where he left off. Is that okay? So if we know that there is judgment coming for sin, how do we as believers live out this age, walk through it, and see, as the man of God said this morning, that there's not only going to be judgment, but revival's running right alongside it. There's not only going to be a reckoning, but there's going to be a harvest right alongside it. Hallelujah. So it's a time of triumph and joy for the church as well. Jeremiah 15, verse 5 and verse 6. Indeed, who will have pity on you, Jerusalem? Or who will mourn for you? Or who will turn aside to ask about your welfare? You who have forsaken me. You keep going backward, so I will stretch out my hand against you. He's talking about Israel, the chosen ones, the ones he loved, the ones that we are a type and a shadow of what Christ has done for our life, but we're also tied in with the Jews. How many of you know that? How many of you pray for the peace of Jerusalem every day? If you don't, you should. But he says here, you keep going backward, so I will stretch out my hand against you and destroy you. I am tired of relenting. I will winnow them, verse 7, with a winnowing fork at the gates of the land. That's a separation. I will bereave them of children. I will destroy my people. They did not repent of their ways. So for a few more minutes, I'm going to talk to you about repenting and relenting. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, for your word. And I pray, Lord, like arrows, that these verses will fly and lodge in our hearts. In Jesus' name. Amen. The word relent means this. I looked it up both in the Hebrew. I looked it up also in the old Webster's Dictionary, and I love this. To be relentless means this. Showing no promise of abatement or severity of intensity, strength, or pace. In other words, it ain't going to let up the pace. Continuing without becoming weaker. Remaining strict. Remaining determined. Remaining persistent. Implacable, never ceasing, steady and sustained. And Bert, I didn't know y'all were going to get to be here, but it was funny because whenever I looked up the word relentless and I pulled it up, it pulled up an apparel that police officers wear that's called a relentless defender. And especially since we've been seeing so many of the of folks coming out against our armed forces, and they've come out against our police departments, they've come out against all authority. We're seeing rebellion in our land like never before. Can I get an amen, somebody? So somebody came out with a line of clothing supporting our men in blue, hallelujah, or khaki, as it were. And it's called Relentless Defender. And that those people, even when we don't want them around, even when they're people who are coming against authority, they're staying firm on set. They have set their course. They've got their mind made up. They're going to do their job. Amen. And they're going to protect the weak. And so I thank God for that. But there is something about your God you may not know. Your God can be relentless. And there's a time for God to be relentless. There's a time for God to not slack, but to really pour it on. I want you to go with me to 1 Samuel chapter 15. I'm going to just kind of hit and miss on these verses, and you can read the whole chapter if you would like. I touched on this when I was preaching about the false prophets, Miranda. Right toward the very end on Saturday, I wrapped it up by just touching on this, but I'm going somewhere with it then that I couldn't go now that I couldn't go then. So what it says is, 1 Samuel chapter 15, The Lord has spoken and told Saul to take out Agag and the Amalekites. It says in verse 1, Samuel said to Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint you as king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, listen to the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, Jehovah Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts, the Lord of all the hosts of heaven. I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel, how he set himself up against him on the way while he was coming up from Egypt. Now go and strike Amalek and utterly destroy all that he has. And this sounds so severe and so ruthless that it takes our breath away, but I'm going to show you what it's a type for. Do not spare him. He said, put him to death, putting both man and woman, child, infant, ox, sheep, camel, and donkey to death. Why was God so ruthless with the Amalekites? Because every time that Israel had decided to bring the pagan wives in, mix with other cultures, Israel did not get that culture saved. Israel turned to idolatry. Are y'all with me? Every time they forsook the values that God gave them, every time that they broke a commandment of the Lord, they went the other way. So he said, literally, I don't want you bringing them in here. I don't even want their goats. I don't even want their cattle. I don't want anything to taint y'all. Take them out. Do what I've told you to do. If you don't, they're going to keep coming after you until they destroy you. So go ahead and take them out. This is a type for you and I to start being ruthless with sin. And I use this a lot of times with folks when I talk to them about dealing with sin in their life. If you saw a snake slip in under the door into your child's bedroom, would you go to sleep that night, or would you stay up as long as it took to hunt that snake down? You didn't know what kind of snake it was. You just saw a snake. You saw it as it's finishing sliding under the door. You open the door. You can't find it, but you know it's in there. Would you rest until you rooted that sucker out and killed it? I don't know about you, but I would not go to bed that night. If it was my baby or one of my grandbabies, I'm going to hunt that snake down, and I'm going to do whatever. If I have to burn the house down, that thing ain't going to be there no more. Help me, somebody. But why is it that we play patty cake with sin? We keep hanging around it. We keep hanging around it. We keep just messing with it. And you know, we'll flip off of a channel that we know that's bad. But then we'll find our little thumb wandering back over there because there's something really cool about that show you wanted to watch. And next thing you know, you're watching a sex scene. Next thing you know, they're using the Lord's name in vain because you didn't kill that snake when it first popped up its head. You heard the Holy Spirit warn you, and you didn't do it, and now it's back. Now it's done bit you. Verse 6. So Saul said to the Kenites, go depart, go down from among the Amalekites, so that I do not destroy you with them, for you showed kindness to all the sons of Israel. And they came up from Egypt, so the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites. God is into separation. God is into sanctification. He does not want you to have any type of alignment with something that is evil or wrong. He gave the Kenites a chance to get out while they could. I don't know if y'all hearing this or not, but we're going to totally dress it out for you, all right? So Saul defeated the Amalekites, just like he was supposed to. From Havilah, as you go down to Shur, which is east of Egypt, he captured Agag, the king of the Amalekites, alive. He utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. Well, almost. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep and the oxen and the fatlings and the lambs and all that was good, and were not willing to destroy them utterly, but everything despised and worthless that they utterly destroyed. So you can have all the stuff that you were trying to sell in your rummage sale. I want what's in your jewelry drawer. And that little cull that you tried to sell me, I don't want that. I want the best calf that you got. He went ahead and kept all the good stuff. That is not what God told him to do. In other words, he decided to reinterpret what God said. And we do that. See, here's the thing. We are really, really strong on other people's stuff and other people's sin, but our own pet sins, we try to negotiate with God. Okay, Jimmy, we're taking up where you left off, brother. And here's what happens. Verse 10, then the word of the Lord came to Samuel, saying, I regret that I made Saul king, for he has turned back from following me. He has not carried out my commands. Samuel was distressed. He cried out to the Lord all night. He rose early in the morning to meet Saul. And it was told Samuel, saying, and Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he set up a monument for himself. I love this. Saul was so happy with himself, he set himself up a monument. And of course, we don't do that today. I mean, spiritual leaders don't build monuments to themselves, do they? Yeah, they do. They're called churches. Or the Memorial Fellowship Wing. Or the, okay, never mind. Our ministries. We get so full of our, Saul so full, and he decides now he's a priest too, so he's making sacrifices. He's just biting off more than he can chew, and God's not really happy with him. Verse 14, Samuel said, he comes there, he meets Samuel saying, look, I'm so cool. I did what God told me to do. Samuel said, verse 14, what is this bleeding of the sheep in my ears, lowing of oxen? Saul said, they have brought them up. I love this, how he throws his other people. He's looking for his armor bearer, Tim. It's Tim's fault. You know, my team, you know, thought, God, that maybe we should do. Now, you know what? It's on me. If I do something with this ministry God's given me that's not of God, it's on me. It's not on the people who work with me. It's on me. And Saul didn't even want to take responsibility for what he did. Oh, Lord. Yeah, these sermons are going to make us lots of friends in high places. The people spared the best of the sheep and oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God. You put a little spiritual spin on it. But the rest we have utterly destroyed. And Samuel said to Saul, wait and let me tell you what the Lord said to me last night. He said, speak. Is it not true that when you were little in your own eyes, you were made the head of the tribes of Israel, and the Lord anointed you king over Israel? The Lord sent you on a mission. It basically said he told you to go kill the Amalekites. And then it says in verse 20, Saul said to Samuel, I did obey the voice of God. I went on the mission. I brought back Agag. That's not what he said. He didn't say bring back Agag. He said take out Agag. He said, and I killed the Amalekites. He's still trying to spin it. But the people, this, Tim, if I ever do this to you, God help me and forgive me. I'll apologize in advance right now. But we have swords, so we really have to be careful. But it's the people. They took some of the spoil and the sheep and the oxen and all that stuff. And Samuel said, has the Lord as much delight, this is verse 22, in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. Rebellion is as the sin of divination or of witchcraft, and insubordination as iniquity and idolatry. He actually said, Saul said to Samuel, I have sinned, I have indeed transgressed, but can I just jump to the chase here? Agag comes walking up, the king, and he's trying to speak words of peace and trying to make things all smooth. And this is actually one of my, maybe it's because I'm a sword guy and spears and weapons and all that, but he's walking up and he's acting like this is, you know, he's being a politician. He just got his butt kicked in a battle, but he's going to see if he can make a nice soft place for himself. Saul has basically allowed him to come into the camp. And he's going, is it peace, brother? And Samuel looks at him and goes, you know, you have made so many women widows, and you have killed so many children, and you've killed, you know what? Here's what I got for you. Runs him through with a spear and kills him. And Saul's just like, I'm going to tell you why I'm giving you this example before I even launch into this message. Agag represents our carnal, sinful nature. Saul was so proud of himself for what he did, but he did not obey God. God is looking for two things from us right now in the kingdom. Obedience. So it's not that God doesn't want you to sacrifice. He wants the sacrifice of a broken and contrite spirit. He wants you to present your body a living sacrifice, but he wants obedience even more. He wants the obedience and the sacrifice. He wants obedience and he wants separation between us and this world, because right now there is no separation. Saul was in bed with Agag. He was in bed with the sin. And what is happening right now is an unholy alliance between churches and the world. We have an unholy alliance where churches are saying, no, we must be tolerant. We must allow these kinds of things, and we are ordaining homosexuals. It's happening. in mainline denominational churches that would have stood against it for most of their years, but now we find them ordaining homosexuals. They're embracing all kinds of cultures and things. They're even saying, well, you know what? Perhaps the same God we worship is the God that the Muslims worship. And when a pastor friend of mine took me in his office the other day and said, look, I was supposed to preach this conference. I had to cancel, but they sent me a tape of it. Look at this. And he shows me one of the major Christian networks is doing a live feed from this conference, a Pentecostal or a Holy Ghost type conference. And he said, this is the guy who took my place and spoke. And it was a very famous black prophet. And I'm not going to say what his name was, but this guy's very well known, very, very famous. And he stands up in the pulpit and he begins to rant. And then he stops in the middle of that and he's attacking. And it was a very racial type of thing. And folks, I got a problem with racism from any direction, okay? I don't think that's the love of God. So don't get me wrong here. But he begins to rant, and then he says, I want to welcome my friends. And he said, you folks stand up. And the first three rows stood up, and it was the Nation of Islam with their leader. And they're up there talking about the Million Man March. And so we're talking about, he said, look, I think as Pentecostals, we should stand with our brothers, the Muslims, and we're going to have a million-man march on Washington, and we're going to come against this this oppression and colonialism and all this stuff, and you know, we're going to burn the rebel flags and all this. And so we're literally talking about, I can't even pull up his name right now. Anybody remember what the guy who's over the Nation of Islam? It was Louis Farrakhan was in a Pentecostal church at a live conference, and he stands up with all of his leadership. And here's this guy saying, and I want to thank, I'm going to hold off of naming the network, okay? I want to thank this network for their courage of seeing Muslims and Christians come together to do this. And what you saw there was not true unity. What you saw there was mixture. What you saw there was an unholy alliance for unholy reasons. That's what was happening with Saul and Agag. In the name of the Lord. Y'all still with me? So here he is, Agag's in bed with Saul, and Samuel comes right up and does something about it. But God's asking for us to be sanctified and separate. Come out from among them and be you separate. I'm not talking about race right now. I'm talking about sin. Go to 1 Peter chapter 4. I'm reading a lot of scripture this afternoon. Is that okay with you? I hope so, because I'm going to do it anyway. Hallelujah. Because I know Pastor Glenn likes it. 1 Peter chapter 4. Look at verse 16 through 18. I want to prove what I'm saying to you today. And then I'm going to show you the position that God wants us to be in as believers. But if anyone suffers as a Christian, he is not to be ashamed, but to glorify God in this name. Remember what Jimmy said earlier today? We're talking about sin being so bold, it's knocking on the church door. And demanding to come in. It's saying, I should be a part of this. Yes, they should if they'll renounce their sin. If they'll turn, amen. But it says in verse 17, for it is time for judgment to begin with the household of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? But if it is with difficulty that the righteous are saved, what will become of the godless man and the sinner? Did you catch that? Therefore, those who also are suffering according to the will of God shall entrust their souls to a faithful Creator in doing what is right. God always does the right thing. He expects us to do the right thing. And I know this is a hard line. Y'all know me. Y'all know what I like to preach about. I love to preach about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. I love to preach about signs and wonders. I love to preach about the glory of God. I love that stuff. And I have more of a presence type ministry. The Spirit of God comes in. God touches people, lives are healed, chains are broken. That's why we connected with Miranda and then from the very first, because we just kind of felt that same thing and had the same direction. But when it comes to sin, God is doing something. I think you felt something in my brother who preached this morning. God's ramping it up in him. And he told me, I think I can say this, he was probably telling you this. In the Sunday school class, he said, something you prophesied over me, I felt like never before. I felt the echoes of the people who mentored me coming through in me. And if you know who mentored Jimmy, I'm bragging on Jimmy just a little bit. You know, if he gets a big head, we'll pop it next. But anyway, he came up under David Wilkerson and Leonard Ravenhill. He said, I felt my spiritual fathers. I just felt all the stuff that God released in me through them boiling up in me. I wanted to preach like them today. And it was there. Amen? Something needs to happen to the church to stir us back to righteousness. Oh, wow. And he expects it to happen for us first. So I find all these scriptures about relenting, for God to relent, what it means. I just got through reading what it meant to be unrelenting or relentless. And I went to the book of Amos. Amos chapter 1 and chapter 2. I'm not going to read them for you. I'm just going to kind of draw from them. If you get a chance after this, read what happens in those two chapters. God starts naming all these judgments. And he starts calling out cities and peoples that he's going to judge. Y'all have a problem with me preaching about judgment? Maybe I'll preach about mercy and grace next time I'm here, okay? Since all you have to do is just turn on any Christian programming and you're going to hear 90% grace and mercy anyway, and love, is it okay if I bring a little balance to the force? Smile. Star Trek reference. Okay. Star Wars. See, I'm not even a good nerd. Must be the hog. Okay. He says in Amos, I'm going to send judgment because of the sins of Damascus, the sins of Gaza, the sins of Tyre. If you know anything about Tyre and Sidon, they received judgment from God. The sins of Edom, the sins of Moab, the sins of Ammon, the sins of Judah and Israel. And he names 32 judgments. And I'm not going to name the judgments, but I'm going to read you a few of the sins that God was having to judge. Tell me if this sounds like where we're at in America. Are y'all still with me? Yes. I know your tummies are full. We'll have you jump up and do a Jericho march if you fall asleep. All right. And we're talking about the relentless nature of God. He said, here are the sins that you did that's bringing this judgment. You despised the law of the Lord. In other words, they didn't like the word. Did not keep my commandments. They erred through the lies they were telling. And of course, we're not hearing any lies on TV every night or from our politicians, right? Wow. Perhaps there has been. Have you ever noticed so much deceit?
Yes.
Satan is the father of lies. He said, you walked in the sins of your fathers. You sold the righteous for silver. You sold out your brothers. You sold the poor for a pair of shoes. You don't really care about the poor. You'd sell them out for a pair of shoes. You'd kill them for a pair of Nikes. Come on, y'all. Don't let me lose you. You're covetous. You're coming against the meek. You're attacking the meek. These are what's in these two chapters here. And it really gets really, really gnarly here. Father and son are going in to see the same woman. Perversion, sexual perversion. Of course, there's no incest in the South or North or East or West or in the Midwest. Right? Very first church I ever pastored had a homosexual ring in it of four young people. And I thought that was bad. I was a youth pastor, and I ended up being the senior pastor of that church. But when I started digging, I found out the reason that all of them were caught up in these kinds of sins because they were all getting raped and molested by their own parents. Don't get quiet on me. It's that sin we don't talk about. And because we don't talk about it, people come to church, and they're so messed up and flipped around and screwed up in their head, they can't serve in any capacity because they don't feel worthy because of what was done to them in the innocence of childhood. Right. When we need to let God heal us, amen, restore us so we can restore others. Amen. I have great news for you. There's hope. Yes. But God hates this sin, especially on the innocent. And then he said, idolatry, I'm judging you for idolatry. He said this in these chapters, you made holy Nazarites to drink wine. Now, if that doesn't jump out to you, the Nazarite vow was that they would not drink any wine, they wouldn't touch anything dead. They made this vow, they weren't born into the priesthood, and they grew their hair out, you know, and they did it to set themselves apart unto God. as an outward sign, they did it, of an inward change that was happening in their life. They weren't born into the priesthood. Their devotion and their holiness brought them into the priesthood. But to take someone who made a holy vow to God to not do it and tempt them or persuade them or force them to drink wine to break their vow. In other words, it's not enough that I'm in sin. I'm going to make sure you fall too. Because I'm so caught up in my sin, I'm going to justify myself. Hey, the Nazarite boy did it. That kid with the long hair. Just messing with you, dude. Jimmy and I both have to get at least one shot in, Malachi. You know, we're here. Just kind of, we love him so much. He made a Nazarite break their vow and drink wine, provoked God to anger, forbade prophets to prophesy. Of course, that didn't happen today. This one really, really stood out to me. They ripped open pregnant women and tore the baby out of them. And then they would rip up their womb. This is the sin that was going on that God said, now look at me. Of course, that's not happening in America today. But God said, I'm going to send back in the day. Now, you know why they did it then? They did it then so that the Israelites would not procreate and get strong. They didn't want a strong, godly people, culture, rising up. So they decided, well, we're just going to shred the women. We're going to rip them. Where we're going to kill the baby that's in them if they're carrying a baby. And we're going to take away their ability to have a baby in the future. We're just going to destroy them just like that. How cruel, how cold, how callous in sin. And we look at this in horror of something that was happening back in the day, and yet we're dismantling them in the womb. Planned Parenthood isn't telling people what they're doing with the fetal tissue, but it comes out, ah ha ha, your sin will find you out. And we find out they're selling. Oh, they're acting like they're all so high and mighty, but they're selling the body parts. They're selling the infants. And by the time these women many times go through something like some of these backroom abortions, they're not able to ever have children again, many of them. Nobody's talking about that. Boy, it's got quiet in here. I'm glad I'm in a church where folks love me. Hallelujah. And we wonder why God said, I will not relent on my judgment that's coming. There's a locomotive coming down the track. It's up. And we talked about God's character this morning. Understand, sin puts you at, the Bible says, enmity, E-N-M-I-T-Y, with God. It literally means sin makes you God's enemy. Now I'm fixing to totally mess with your theology. How many of you have heard the quote, but I want to see how honest you are because my hand's about to go up here. How many of you have repeated the quote, God hates the sin, but he loves the sinner? Okay, we got the rest of your liars. Okay. Don't tell me you've never heard that in church. Oh, he hates the sin, but he loves the sinner. And we use that's when we really won't go as far as some are going with the sin that's in the church, but we're still being tolerant. And we're showing, but guess what? That is not theologically correct. Now, you might just be shocked about that. Oh, what kind of a cruel, cold man are you, Pastor? No, please understand. God is so holy. Does he love the sinner? Yes, he does. He loves them because they are his creation. And he wants to give them his best. But when sin remains in you and you make a choice to whether you're going to serve God and obey him or stay in the sin, God's saying, you made a choice. You made a choice on whose team or whose family you're going to be on. You made a choice. Because I can't lie, I'm God, and I'm holy, and my nature is holy. Your sin has set you apart from me and set you adrift from me and actually turned your face against me in rebellion. And rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft because I dealt with you and I dealt with you and I dealt with you and I dealt with you. But you did not repent. Go with me to John chapter 3. I'm going to pull out two passages out of John chapter 3. That's the Gospel of John chapter 3. Anybody getting anything out of this so far? Yeah. John chapter 3, look at verse 36. John 3:36 says, the Father loves the Son. Hallelujah. Yes. Verse 35, has given all things into his hand. He who believes in the Son has eternal life, but he who does not obey the Son will not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. But I want to back up now into the same chapter and show you what came before that. Verse 17 through 21, we're talking about believing in God, believing in the Son. He who believes in him is not judged, but he who does not believe has been judged already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. This is the judgment, that the light is come into the world. Men love the darkness rather than the light, for their deeds were evil. For everyone who does evil hates the light, who does not come to the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. He who practices the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be manifested as having been wrought in God. You're going to choose darkness or you're going to choose light. There's two teams. There is not a gray team. There is a team of light and there's a team of darkness. You're either for the darkness or you're for the light. Because of that, judgment has come on people's head. Go to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. I'm giving you the foundation for where we're going, and I'm fixing to hit you with some heavy hooks. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26 and verse 27. If we go on sinning willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth, truth was referenced earlier in that third chapter of John, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a terrifying expectation of judgment and the fury of fire. I just stopped and thought about something. I'm preaching hellfire and brimstone.
Amen. Amen.
Strangely enough, it is. A terrifying expectation of judgment and the fury of fire which will consume the adversaries. Anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses, but how much severer punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and insulted the Holy Spirit? God goes on to say, vengeance is mine. You trampled the blood of my Son Jesus. Jesus didn't come to do away with the law. Jesus came to fulfill the law.
Mm-hmm.
So there's two things you need to know about God. God hates sin. And God's ways are perfect. And y'all know that my mind works a little strangely, and there's always some kind of humor seasoned in with it. I also read some scriptures about salt. I liked what he said, and I think I might even have one later in here. But y'all remember the O.J. Simpson trial? If the glove does not fit, you must quit. I'm old enough to remember. It was cool, you know. I mean, back then, kind of watched that back and forth. First time we were kind of pulled into the whole legal system when we watched it. But can I just say you God's version of this? If you do not repent, I will not relent. If you do not repent, I will not relent. And it's nothing funny about it. So I'm saved now, Lord. I'm saved. I heard the word. I got right with God. What about living in a land that's not saved? What about living in a land that judgment is headed to? What just happened in France, if you don't think that's going to happen worldwide, then you need to talk to your pastor. It's coming. What about our land? If there's an unstoppable locomotive of God's judgment headed down the track with a full head of steam, and we must see our land saved, and we must see our culture saved, where do we fall as the church? Lot tried to placate, and they just about ran him over. He was willing to give. In that sermon this morning, I got to reference it because it just dovetails everything. If he was willing to even give his children over to a culture that was going to just destroy him, eat him up and destroy him, Rather than standing there firmly as a man of God and rebuking them, he had two angels from the Lord. I looked at this, and part of what I'm going to be sharing with you is the judgment that came when David tried to number Israel. He tried, 70,000 died in one day. There's another tale about one angel fighting 185,000 men of war, trained men of war, and in one night he wiped out all of them. One angel. He's got two angels. Okay, let's do the math. That's a lot of people. The two angels could wipe out. Anyway, just 185,000. You got two of them. And he's willing to let them take his daughters, his virgin daughters. And I don't know about you. I got one girl and one boy, but it wouldn't matter, boy or girl. I'm going to fight you till the last breath in my body, till there's not a drop of blood in my body. You're not taking my kids. I'm going to fight with everything that I have. And I'm not even talking about Christianity right now. I'm just talking about justice. Don't mess with my babies. Can I get a witness, somebody? But can you imagine being so affected by the sin culture around you that you thought the solution was, I'm just going to give you my kids so that I don't break the rules of what? Hospitality? And isn't that what's twisting our arm? Kevin, that's insane to me. It's like, but you don't understand. We've got to play nice, you know, so we need to go ahead and ordain homosexuals. Maybe we're just hitting on that one particular sin too much today. Name the sin. We're finding that we're rolling over to be tolerant for it. Whether it's drinking, whether it's doing drugs, we're rolling over to be tolerant. We just want to throw the door. Listen, yes, we do. And yes, God does love the sinner. Yes, we do too. But God hates the sin so much. He can't even stand the smell of it. He can't stand the sight of it. He's so holy and so pure, he can't stand to be around it. So what he wants us to do is to give them the truth and to shine the light and to see the judgment fall off of them so that they can be made whole. Historically, judgment, and this is where I'm taking this someplace where we don't usually understand. Historically, both in the Old Testament and the New Testament and in revival history, many times judgment has preceded the mightiest moves of God. Both of our great awakenings in America happened during a time of economic and political upheaval and wars and rumors of wars. The country was in bad shape and people turned to God. Sadly, it takes crisis sometimes for people to turn to God. We're not praying for judgment. We're asking God to hold back his hand of judgment. But God is saying, will you do your part? Oh my. So I looked at some of this. Judgment through 10 plagues that came upon Egypt caused Israel to be finally released out of Egyptian bondage. Come on, somebody. Amen. Those plagues came and it, look, don't get on God's bad side. Pharaoh had a chance. He let them go. They left. He changed his mind and decides to come after God's people again. And splish splash, he was taking a bath. David pridefully numbered Israel and an angel slew 70,000. David throws himself on a threshing floor, cries out to God, God, I repent of my pride. He only did it because it made him look good. Oh, I'm going to number Israel. Look how I've grown the kingdom. Look what a good. And you know what? Spiritual leaders and politicians do the same thing. And even leaders of a business or leaders of a family. Oh, look, I'm going to take credit for something that should be given over to God. Come on, y'all. And then judgment came, and he threw himself on the floor. He said, God, have mercy. Forgive me of my sin. Don't judge your people. Kill me and my household if you need to. We don't see that kind of sacrifice. You won't sacrifice, there's sacrifice for you. But in both obedience and sacrifice, he throws himself on. And you know what? He even said, I will not. So the guy who owned the threshing floor said, I'll give you an oxen. I'll help you build. He goes, no, I'm going to pay you the full price because I'm no longer going to offer up a sacrifice that didn't cost me anything. No more freebies. Paid in full. When he offered up the sacrifice, not only did God avert the judgment and lift the hand of that destroying angel, but God caused that place to be the place where Solomon's temple was eventually built. And it was where Zionic worship was birthed and born, and it changed the face of worship forever. And David was able to come in and bring the ark in, sacrificing and dancing, unbridled passion before God, and undignified, didn't care what, he threw off those kingly robes and put on the robes of a servant priest, and the glory of God came back, but he had to repent first. Could have done it in his own power, Danny. Could have done it in all the glory and wealth that Israel had, but it had to come through brokenness, repentance, and sacrifice. And if we're going to see our culture change, it's got to begin in you and I. Go to the book of Jonah, chapter 3. I'm moving very quickly. I know I'm giving you a lot of scripture. Book of Jonah. We're back over in the Old Testament, back over in the minor prophets. Everybody knows the story of Jonah, but I just want to pull out one or two things from it to show you, because I absolutely love this. Jonah was not the typical evangelist, was he? Jonah, Micah. I think it's just before Micah. If I remember, did y'all learn the Bible like that by singing it? Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk. Okay. Jonah chapter 3. And we know what happens. You know, he doesn't want to preach. God gets his attention. He gets swallowed up by a whale. He gets puked up on the beach for the Ninevites. And it says in verse 4, Then Jonah began to go through the city. One day's walk, he cried out and he said, "Yet 40 days and Nineveh will be overthrown." He preached it. Then the people of Nineveh believed in God. They called a fast, put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least. And then, what a revival. Judgment is coming if you don't repent. And they repented and they got saved. Hallelujah. When the word reached the king of Nineveh, he arose from his throne, lay aside his robe from him, covered himself with sackcloth, sat on ashes, issued a proclamation, and said, "In Nineveh, by the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let man, beast, herd, or flock taste a thing. Don't let them eat or drink water. But both man and beast must be covered with sackcloth, and let men call on God earnestly." Oh, in America today, we want this to happen. Lord, I pray for Nineveh, New York. I pray for Nineveh, New Orleans. I pray for Nineveh, Baton Rouge. Help us, Jesus. I pray for Nineveh, Simsport. Amen. Come on. Amen. Call on God earnestly that each may turn from his wicked way and the violence which is in his hands. Who knows that God may turn and, say it with me, relent and withdraw his burning anger that we will not perish. God saw their deeds, turned away from their wicked way they did, and God relented concerning the calamity which he had declared he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. God knows that if you will repent, he will relent. But this is crazy. Look at what happens in chapter 4, verse 2. Jonah gets upset. He prayed to the Lord and said, "Please, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my own country? I told you this would happen, Lord. Therefore, in order to forestall this, I fled to Tarshish, for I knew that you're..." This is crazy. "I knew that you are gracious and compassionate, God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, and one who relents concerning calamity. Therefore now, Lord, just kill me." Is this where we're at? Is that our reason? What is our reason that we're not preaching truth? "I told you this would happen, God, if I stood on the street corner and begin to cry out, and the glory of God started shaking. I knew this would happen. Now they're getting saved." And they did get saved. Can I say to you, the word of God still has power. Amen. The word of God still has authority. Amen. There is still a mighty unction and anointing upon the word of God. God wants you to speak the word with boldness. He will still save your city. He will still save your family. He'll still save your land. He's looking for a man or woman. Jonah did not want to do it because he hated that culture. Maybe what's happened is, if you want to talk about the love of God, maybe we ought to love people enough to tell them the truth. Do that in love. Don't do it in a judgmental, critical spirit, but do that in love. Jonah did do one thing right, though. He finally obeyed God. Even if he did it reluctantly, he obeyed God. Maybe you're reluctant to go out door-to-door witnessing. Maybe you're reluctant to try to win somebody to the Lord at the checkout counter in the supermarket. But my friend, we're coming up here in just a minute, and many of you will want me to pray for you. And I love praying for you and ministering to you. And I'll pray for people for healing for their body. I'll pray for the salvation of their household and family. I'll release spiritual gifts and pray for God to baptize you in the Holy Ghost and fire. But you know something? It ain't enough for you to come here and get fed both literally and spiritually. And being so in love with your own ease that all those spiritual truths that you have heard, both sung and spoken here, don't manifest enough in you for you to obey God, move in a sacrificial obedience, and take this word outside this church to the lost and the dying.
Amen.
And if you want to talk about judgment, woe unto us. One preacher said, woe unto me if I preach not the gospel. And I'll say it to you like this. Woe unto me if I preach not the gospel. Woe unto me if I don't tell people the truth. If we're in a culture where judgment is coming. How many of you believe Jesus is coming soon? How many of you believe that God still judges sin? He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Then what are we doing? If they're tied to the train tracks and the locomotive is coming down the track, are you just going to stand there and fold your arms and shake your head and go, it's just terrible what's about to happen to them? Poor people. If they were members of our church, it probably wouldn't happen. Well, maybe.
Come on.
Jonah rebels, gets judgment, then he repents. God relents for him. And then the people of Nineveh repented, and God relented. God still is into relenting if we'll just repent. Judgment brought revival in the book of Acts. Go to Acts chapter 5. I love this. What I'm about to read to you, what I've already been reading to you, you're not hearing preached in Sunday morning pulpits these years. Look at Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5. Everybody knows the story of Ananias and Sapphira. I'll just give you the short version because I want to show you what happens at the end. We always talk about what happened to them, but never talk about what happens at the end. They sold a piece of land. New Testament church was blowing up. God was moving. People were giving to the Lord. They wanted to show how great a giver they were. Sold a piece of land. Say they were giving all the value of it to the church. Lied about it. Ananias was the first one to tell the fib. Holy Ghost slays him. I mean kills him. I'm talking about slayed in the spirit. We're talking about laid out, gone, he's dead. You know, go straight to hell. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Straight to hell. Sapphira comes in. They give her a chance to tell the story straight. She lies to the Holy Spirit. I mean, if you go to lie to your preacher, but don't lie to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's on. Now, wait a minute. But if this preacher's full of the Holy Ghost, but uh-oh. I did that on purpose. I confess. Okay. You lied to God. Sometimes when you lie to one of his servants, you're lying to God. And she lied and she died and she probably fried. But what I was looking at was this, preacher. Verse 10. Immediately she fell at his feet, breathed her last. The young men came in and found her dead, and they carried her out and buried her beside her husband. But I love this. And great fear came over the whole church and over all who heard of these things. Talking about the fear of the Lord, holy trembling. And the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were taking place among the people. And they were all in one accord in Solomon's portico. None of them dared to associate with them. People were scared of them. However, the people held them in high esteem. All the more believers in the Lord, multitudes of men and women were constantly added to their number. This is happening immediately after Ananias and Sapphira croak. To such an extent that they were carried the sick out in the streets, laid them on cots and pallets, and when Peter came by, at least his shadow might fall on some of them. People from the cities in the vicinity of Jerusalem were coming together, coming all over the place, bringing people who were sick or afflicted or with unclean spirits, and they were all being healed. Right after judgment came revival. Because we're all going, Lord, hold back your judgment, hold back your judgment, hold back your judgment. Maybe we need to pray the purpose and plan of God. Pray mercy. Can I share something else that might rock your theology a little bit? For years, people come to me, oh, Brother Paul, listen, I need you to pray for little Johnny. Little Johnny's, you know, 39 years old and doesn't work and lives at home with his mother and, you know, drinks beer all day long. Pray for little Johnny. Pray for him. Come on, y'all, smile at me. Dog has mange. I mean, you know, it's just bad. You know, just basically think of the worst country western song you can imagine. Anyway, pray that he'll get well and get over this sickness that he has. Sickness is laziness, by the way. But anyway, pray for him to, and pray, you know, he just doesn't feel well, you know, and that and he needs a job real bad, you know. And so they're basically praying all these blessings. And so I'll pray for Johnny and he'll get a job and then he'll blow that off one day and not go to work and lose the job. Then I'll pray for Johnny and he'll get to feeling better and he'll get to feeling so much better that now he's able to go out and drink. And we're praying for mercy, and Johnny gets in a car crash and comes out of it miraculously and doesn't die. And we're praying for more mercy, and all these God's just keeps barely sparing this boy. Again, come on, y'all, are y'all with me on this? Anybody know what I'm talking about? And we'll pray, and we will pray them healthy and happy and smiling all the way to hell. Because God will honor our prayers. We don't want anything bad to happen to our loved ones. When what we should be praying, perhaps, if we really want to see them in eternity, is, God, I'm asking you to spare their life, but let him wake up in the hog pen, smelling like pig slop, can't find nothing to eat, eating a corn shuck, chewing on a cob of corn, ain't got nothing on it. Let come on, somebody. Let him wake up in jail. Don't know how he got there. If you have to, God, whatever you do, take your hedge about that I've been praying about little Johnny off. Lord, I'm asking you to spare his life, but Lord, take down the hedge. And let little Johnny come to a place of decision that he is screwing his life up major and desperately needs Jesus. And can I say to you, there are many in the earth today, especially in America, that are so entitled and everything's free. You don't have to starve in America. You can live homeless if you want to, but you don't have to starve in America. Somewhere in America, somebody's going to feed you, okay? And in America, there's more jobs available. In America, there's more goodies. There's more technology. There's more of anything. There's better education. There's all these things. We have so much, and yet we do not turn to God, and we do not thank God, and we're not grateful to God. And judgment is coming, my friend, because God is not two-faced. We need to pray for revival judgment. If judgment's coming, then God, I want to see revival come out of it. I want to see out of this a nation fall on their knees before God and begin to cry out to God. I hope you're not upset with me, but I'm giving you what I feel like God's told me to say. It's a very, very difficult thing. But if your doctor says to you, I need to cut this out of you. If I cut it out of you, you'll live. If I don't cut it out of you, you will die. Okay. Most of you would say, okay, cut out of me. Let me think about it. Okay. Look at Mark. Oh, no. Go to Acts chapter 12. Talk about revival judgment. I love this. I'm having so much fun. I'm getting to practice on y'all. I'm going to take this in some churches where they may throw hymn books at me. Okay. Acts chapter 12, verse 21. Herod's tried to persecute the Christians. He's done all this bad stuff. But on an appointed day, verse 21, Herod, having put on, talking about political leader here, put on his royal apparel, took his seat on the rostrum, began delivering an address to them. And the people kept crying out, the voice of a God and not of a man. And you know what? We've done that with our politicians too. And immediately, an angel of the Lord struck, not the devil, an angel of the Lord struck him because he did not give God the glory, and he was eaten by worms and died. But the word of the Lord continued to grow and be multiplied. He died, and revival continued. I've only got a couple of more passages. Do y'all have time for this? I'm not trying to preach you happy today, but I'm about to get us ready for something. In Mark chapter 9, book of Mark chapter 9, I struggled with this, and I'm going to tell the people, Danny, what I told someone a little bit earlier. Some sermons tear you, and as a young minister, I'm going to release this into you. Some sermons tear you going in and tear you coming out. I struggle with preaching this. This is about the justice of God. We're talking about things coming to order. We're talking about a call of duty. The call of duty that I'm releasing to you right now is for you to go and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. In a time of judgment hitting the earth, will you preach? Will you teach? Will you witness? That's the call to duty. Everybody hearing me? So when I read Mark chapter 9, verse 42. Got a new Bible. Pages are sticking. Verse 42. Whoever causes one of these little ones to stumble, it would be better for him if a heavy millstone hung around his neck. People are, oh, God's a loving God. He would never have anything bad happen to anybody. It'd be better if a millstone was hung around your neck and you were cast into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life crippled than having two hands go into hell and into unquenchable fire, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. If your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better for you to enter into life lame than having, Jesus, this is red letter stuff, Jesus is saying this, having your two feet are to be cast into hell, where the worm does not, there it is again, and the fire is not quenched. I guess Herod really got the whole meaning of that scripture, didn't he? God gave him a little bit of hell on earth just before he found out where there was some really bad worms. If your eye causes you to stumble, throw it out. It's better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than having two eyes to be cast into hell. Obviously, this is a metaphor. Obviously, God's trying to get our attention. Obviously, Christ is trying to make a point here where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched, for everyone will be salted with fire. What? Salt is good, but we're supposed to be salt and light. But if the salt becomes unsalty, with what will you make it salty again? Having salt in yourself, have salt in yourself, be at peace with one another. Everybody look this way. That was a John Kilpatrick phrase, by the way. I borrowed it from you. Look here. What happens whenever the salt is no longer salty? You're salt and light. What happens whenever the candle becomes dim? People can't find their way. What happens whenever salt loses its savor? It doesn't have the ability to change the flavor anymore. It doesn't have the ability to preserve anymore. What happens when the light goes out at the church? What happens when we lose our saltiness? We lose our anointing. We lose the unction of the Holy Spirit. We lose that burning drive and that burning call of God on our life. When that happens, we stop caring about whether what God has done in our life changes people or not. We become selfish. We begin to try to negotiate because it's easier to negotiate than it is to submit. It's easier to negotiate than to be obedient and sacrificial. God, can't you just see it my way? Okay. It's kind of uncomfortable dealing with these issues in my family, in my church, at work. I you know how I hate confrontation, God? You know what? God hates that you hate confrontation. Wishy-washy. Like I said, I'm sorry, I'm just practicing on y'all. God's going to refine this message. So if it's a little bit sharp, it's cutting me too. So here's the word for today. If you don't think that any of the things I said, if that's all Old Testament stuff, you know, judgment, stuff like that, let's go to the most relevant book we can find in the Bible, the book of Revelation. How's that? And we're going to close with this. Sort of. John the Revelator hears from Jesus, and he has a message to seven churches. I'm going to give you what he said to five of those churches, five out of seven. Would you say that the messages to the seven churches in Revelation are one of the most relevant things that we could find in Scripture for today? Would you say that? Yeah. We kind of agreed on that. Yeah. Can I just give you the short version here? Chapter 2, I'm just going to call out verses and I'm going to hit them. Chapter 2, verse 4 and 5 to Ephesus, he said, and he says good things to all these places. Well, there was one he didn't say too much good about, but most of them he said good things about too. There was good and bad, but there were issues that needed to be dealt with. And it says in verse 4 and verse 5 in chapter 2, I have this against you, Ephesus, that you've left your first love. Therefore, remember from where you have fallen and repent. Oh, there's that word repent. And do the deeds you did at first, or else I'm coming to you and I will remove your lampstand out of its place unless you repent. If you don't repent, I will not relent. That's what God is saying. If you don't repent, America, if you don't repent, church at Ephesus, I'm going to remove your candlestick. Can I tell you what that means? I do not believe in the doctrine of eternal security. I think it's a damnable doctrine. I think it's the doctrine of devils. I think it's doomed a lot of people to hell because they repented of something, but then they went right back to sinning. When God says, I'm going to remove your candlestick, and he also talks about, I'm going to remove your name from the book of life. When he says stuff like that, he actually means it. It means you don't get in, you don't have a hall pass.
That's right. Come on. That's right.
Whew. Verse 14 and verse 16, he's talking to, who is it? Talking to Pergamon. But I have a few things against you because you have, there are some who hold the teaching of Balaam. Y'all remember about good old Balaam, don't you? He's a false prophet who kept teaching Balak to put a stumbling block for the sons of Israel. He did it for mammon. He did it for money. Of course, we don't have false prophets who are all in it for the cash these days, all about the Benjamins. We haven't seen any of those cats around, have we? He said, smirking. Anyway, to eat things sacrificed to idols, to commit acts of immorality. So you also have some in the same way holding the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Therefore, repent, or else I'm coming to you quickly. I will make war against them with the sword of my mouth. Guess what he's just rattling off right here? He's talking about false doctrine. He's talking about immorality in the church. He's talking about false prophets. Wonderful. Thyatira. Look at Thyatira, verse 20-23. He said, but I have this against you that you tolerate Jezebel. I love it. Yeah, we put her in the evangelist quarters. Who calls herself a prophetess. She teaches and leads my bondservants away so they commit acts of immorality, eat things sacrificed to idols. So there's Jezebel, there's idols, there's immorality. I gave her time to repent. She doesn't want to repent of her immorality. And see, that's actually in the church too. That's why we actually have people who are in perversion on platforms leading worship. We have pastors who are hooked on pornography, preaching behind the pulpit on Sunday morning, and going to their pastor's office, opening their laptop, and making love with their laptop. Smile, Jesus loves you. And to say to you, the rest who are in Thyatira, who do not hold this teaching, who have and not known the deep things of Satan, as they call them, I place no other burden on you. But it actually said, let me back this up. Verse 22, she didn't want to repent. Verse 22 said, behold, I will throw her on a bed of sickness, those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation, unless they repent of her deeds. I will kill her children with pestilence. Whoa. Oh, this is New Testament. And all the churches will know that all the churches will know. Guys, I'm doing this judgment so the churches will know that I am he who searches the minds and heart. Oh, yeah, I know what you're thinking. I will give to each one of you according to your deeds. Wow. And then finally, well, there's Sardis, not just Sardis, but chapter 3, verse 2 and verse 3. Wake up, strengthen the things that remain which are about to die, for I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of my God. Guess what? God actually spoke that prophetically to me by no one else but John Kilpatrick. One time when I was there to help him on the prayer team, he leaned over and said to me, not all your ways are pleasing to God. You need to repent. I was on the prayer team. Hey, buddy, I'm Louisiana Outpouring. Woo-woo. That man's prayed for me probably 50 times through all the years, and everyone's been a blessing or a prophetic word of great thing. But that time, he bent over and rebuked me. He didn't no more remember me than the man in the moon when he said it either. He just said, the Lord says, you're not pleasing God. You need to repent and get some things straight. I went home, whined and bawled, and my wife said, I can't believe that man of God missed God that way. Don't laugh at me. It'll happen to you if you get prideful. Some of you are so used to telling other people how to live, but you can't take it when somebody says it to you. If you can't stand chasing, you can't stand rebuke, you're headed for a fall, and you'll lead others astray in your fall because you're so puffed up, nobody can tell you nothing. My wife said, well, maybe he's right. Could be. Oh, God worked me over for a month. Not only was he right, I had a lot of repenting to do. Finally, we said verse 3, remember what you have received and heard, keep it and repent. I just gave you the word. Therefore, if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you're not going to know what hour I'll come to you. And basically, he's saying you could miss the boat. Finally, in chapter 3, to the Laodiceans, he says in verse 15 through 20, we're going to use this to close. I know your deeds, that you're neither cold nor hot. I wish you were cold or hot. Because you're lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'll spit you out of my mouth. What do you do when a holy God says, I'm going to spit you, I'm going to vomit you forward? Because you say, I'm rich, I've become wealthy, I don't have need of anything. You do not know that you're wretched, miserable, poor, blind, naked. There was an old fable that was like called The Emperor's New Clothes. Everybody was such a yes man to the king and just kissing up to him all the time. And he finally got so pompous and so puffed up, he walked out in the street in one parade butt naked. And everybody was saying, he goes, how do y'all like my new clothes? Oh, yeah, you look great, big guy. And one little boy standing on the outside goes, you're naked. And I kind of feel like that little boy sometime when I get around so-called spiritual leaders that don't even know how sad shape that they're in. I advise you to buy from me gold refined by fire that you may become rich, white garments that you may clothe yourself, that the shame of your nakedness will not be revealed. I salve to anoint your eyes that you may see. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Now, remember what Jimmy preached this morning, who was knocking at Lot's door. But here's another one knocking. And it's Jesus. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and will dine with him and he with me. Let Jesus in. Let the angels in. Shut the door to everything else. Last night, something came to me and I wrote on Facebook right as I finished this sermon. And I did not intend to include it in this until the Lord spoke to me driving here. It was Isaiah 52:10. I'm just going to read it. I've written it down here. I pinned it in sitting in that Sunday school office a while ago. I'm going to read it to you, but I actually do have one more passage. Everybody turn to Joel chapter 2, and it's going to be what our altar call is going to be. Joel chapter 2. We were all around Amos a while ago. Help me, Holy Spirit. Joel chapter 2, verse 12 through 17, we're going to go to. But let me read you this from Isaiah 52:10. The Lord has bared his holy arm in the sight of all the nations, that all the ends of the earth may see the salvation of our God. And I wrote on there, have you ever seen God flex? That's what I wrote on Facebook last night. And I just kind of wrote that. I didn't really think about why I wrote it or what I wrote it for until I was driving here. And there was a young lady, and I don't even know who she is. She Facebooked me back, and she was really, really excited. She goes, I just came out of a church service, and in that church service, I guess you couldn't believe I wrote this, she said, I saw God's bare arm, and he had it flexed, and I saw this big knot of muscle, And I didn't know why. And I come home and I read your Facebook message. I just put out just for inspirational. She goes, about God's arm being bared. Now, let me take you to this. I'm working out now. I know you can't tell yet. Tim knows because he used to have to pick me up off the pew every time before I go preach. And I'm getting around better. But I haven't flexed anything since my 20s. I'm headed fast towards 60. You know what I'm saying? Glenn, I ain't flexed nothing in a long time. I didn't know I could flex. The other day I flexed. And I went, oh, what's that? Oh, my God, that's a muscle. You know, and I'm not Arnold. You know, I'm not there. But, I mean, I'm going, wow, I haven't had that in a long time. It took a, thank you, Jesus, you know. But in Scripture, when someone got ready to do something strenuous, the men, they would gird their loins, they would pull up their robe, roll it up, tuck it in. They would roll up their, and we get that expression, roll up your sleeves from that. You would bare the arm so the arm could move freely. Be kind of hard to work that metal, wouldn't it, brother? On a hot day, if you were bound up, you got to be able to swing, right? And God said, I'm driving here, God said, and you know me, kid, tell my people I'm about to flex. I'm bearing my arm.
Amen.
Because there's about to be some action that takes place. For some, it's going to be God literally doing this. When we talk about judgment, please don't misunderstand. Most of the time when we talk about judgment, there's been so much mercy given to us from God. All God has to do is just take down the hedge. He's been keeping out the devouring beasts. But when a whole culture or a nation goes into rebellion, when the leadership of the nation mandates that law says, this is the law of the land. Marriage is no longer between a man and a woman, but it's between whoever wants to be with whoever for whatever. When schools change, when the judiciary system says, no, the law of the land is, you can kill a baby anytime you need to. Forget that third trimester thing. We just, in some places, we just kill them anytime you want to kill them. When laws of man go against the laws of God, God starts rolling up his sleeves. When the sin becomes defiant, like he preached this morning, not just talking about backdoor stuff, but now it's out in the open. It's bold sin, and it's arrogant, and it's even being forced on you. I don't care what you say you believe. This is what we say is true. This is the truth that we've picked out. You're going to do this. That's what leads us to the book of Joel. So if people, I have, look, just this year, churches and places where I have preached for years have told me, don't come back.
Amen.
Not because I have fallen in sin, not because I have wounded or hurt somebody in the church, but literally because of what God's had me preaching this year.
Amen.
Places that have had me preach for years no longer want me to come and preach in their church. And they'll even say, not because you're not a good preacher, Brother Bradford, you're a good preacher. People always enjoy you. And God just told them to drop it. They'll just leave it, just walk away. But a couple of them have been honest enough to say to me, here's why we don't want you to come back. We don't want you scaring folks. Okay. Well, there is some of that. We don't want you making people afraid. Here's another one. We're trying to stay positive. Okay. God tells me, don't argue with them. Don't tell them what the scripture says. Don't do anything. Just walk away. Okay. It's nighttime. You're coming up on a bridge. It's been raining. The river's swollen. The bridge's been washed out. You see that. You pull your car over. You turn your flashers on. You try to block the street with your car. You get out of your car and you try to wave down the oncoming traffic. You try to tell them that the bridge is out. And they pull around you and they keep driving. You're screaming, no, turn back. And they go on. And you watch in horror as you can do nothing about it, but you tried. Can I tell you that on that road, some will heed your warning and you will save some. Others will not. But you did what you were supposed to do. You shined a light. You threw yourself on the road. You ran out and you spoke what you were supposed to speak. The thing is, many of us would just turn our car around and drive the other way. I don't want to get involved. You know, I hate confrontation. Warrior up. This is life and death. This is what we're supposed to be doing. Joel chapter 2, verse 12. Yet even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning, and rend your heart and not your garments. Now return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in loving kindness, and relenting of evil. You see, God wants to relent. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent, leave a blessing behind him, even a grain offering, a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow a trumpet in Zion. Consecrate a fast, proclaim a solemn assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and the nursing infants, let the bridegroom come out of his room and the bride out of her bridal chamber, let the priests, the Lord's ministers, weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not make your inheritance a reproach, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? And this is where we're at right now. Will you stand with me?